Duane Allman is widely regarded as one of the greatest guitarists who has ever lived. He can regularly be found in the top 10 lists of the greatest guitarists of all time, sometimes as high as number 2, with only Jimi Hendrix ahead of him. Allman was an innovator who took electric guitar soloing to new heights, especially when using a slide made of a glass bottle of a cough remedy. He was also instrumental in creating the Southern rock genre with the Allman Brothers Band, and at the heart of what many believe to be the best live album ever made. In addition, Allman played on countless classic recordings by the likes of Wilson Pickett, Aretha Franklin, King Curtis, Boz Scaggs, and numerous others. In particular, Allman played a central part in the making of the classic double album by Derek and the Dominoes, Layla and Other Assorted Love Songs. It is widely regarded as Eric Clapton's finest moment and one of the best rock and blues albums of all time. These incredible accomplishments would normally make an impressive summary of a long and checkered career, but astonishingly, Allman achieved them over a course of just a couple of years. Sadly, he died in 1971, just a month short of his 25th birthday. In this video, we'll look at the meteoric rise and sudden fall of Duane Allman, what made him so great and why he is still so relevant today. Howard Duane Allman was born on November the 20th, 1946, in Nashville, Tennessee, as the oldest son of Willis and Geraldine Allman. His brother Gregory was born just over a year later, on December the 8th, 1947. Willis Allman was in the army and murdered by an acquaintance on Boxing Day in 1949. As a result, the two boys were raised by their mother alone. Because she had to hold down a job, the boys were sent to the Castle Heights Military Academy in Lebanon, Tennessee. The ultra-strict regime was very hard on both of them, particularly on Greg. In search of a better life, the family moved to Daytona Beach in Florida in 1957, where the boys attended Seabreeze High School. The family had not been musical in any way until this point. But starting in 1959, several music-related events happened that activated their interest in music and guitar playing. In that year, Greg encountered a guitar-playing neighbor of his grandmother in Nashville, who gave him some lessons. Greg wanted to get his own guitar and started doing a paper round in the spring of 1960. By September, he had saved $21 and he cycled to a Sears department store to buy a Silvertone guitar, which cost $21.95. He had to cycle back home to borrow the remaining 95 cents from his mother. In the same year, the brothers witnessed B.B. King in concert, which led Duane to declare, "We've got to get into this." He nonetheless still had his mind on other things, particularly after his mother bought him a blue Harley-Davidson 165 for his 14th birthday in November of 1960. He ended up making the neighborhood unsafe with it. Greg started teaching his older brother some guitar basics, and Duane soon became interested enough for the two of them to fight over the one guitar. Wisely, their mother decided to give Duane his own acoustic guitar for Christmas. His obvious talent led him quickly to supersede his younger brother. Interestingly, both brothers were left-handed, but played right-handed. Half a year later, in July of 1961, Duane crashed his motorcycle, and from the proceeds of the spares, he managed to buy a 1959 red Gibson Les Paul Jr. Both boys continued to practice hard, and within a year, they both were performing at teen dance parties around Daytona Beach. For the first half of the 60s, Duane and Greg played in or with a succession of bands, starting with The Kings, The Uniques, and The Y-Teens in 1961. In the fall of 1961, Duane was sent back to Castle Heights Academy, where he was joined a year later by his brother. They still hated the academy, but formed the Misfits and the Shufflers there. Duane got kicked out in December of 1963, and Greg eventually left in the spring of the following year. The bands they played in from this point onwards were the Lindsay Morris Band, the House Rockers, Sweet William and the Stereos, and the Escorts. In the spring of 1965, the Escorts recorded at a studio belonging to Lee Hazen in Ormond Beach, Florida, and the band also played support to the Beach Boys at a concert in Daytona Beach. By the summer of the same year, the Escorts, changed their name to the Allman Joys, and Greg also started to sing and play organ. The band cut a single, a cover of Willie Dixon's Spoonful, that was locally successful. The Allman Joys toured extensively, and a 22-week residency at the Sahara Club in Pensacola, Florida, was later regarded by Greg as a real turning point in my life, during which he learned how to deal with an audience. Songwriter John D. Loudermilk spotted the Allman Joys during a gig in the second half of 1966 in Nashville, and he went on to produce some of the sessions with them, as did songwriter John Hurley. The Nashville studios that were used for these sessions were Bradley's Barn, RCA Studio, and Buddy Killen's Studios, but the results were shelved because nobody was too impressed. To Greg Allman's dismay, some of the recordings were released much later in 1973 on an album called Early Allman. At the start of 1967, the Allman Joys changed their name to Almanac, or Allman Act, and they moved to St. Louis, Missouri, where they met the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band and their manager, Bill McEwen. At his suggestion, the Allman Act changed their name to Hourglass and decamped to Los Angeles, where they lived in a hippie crash pad that was also used by the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. By June 1967, McEwen had arranged for Hourglass to sign with Liberty Records, and they started work on an album at Sound Recorder Studios. There were more gigs and more recording sessions at the same studio, and in October, Liberty released the band's self-titled debut album, produced by Dallas Smith. However, the music was in a pop and white soul direction that the band members disliked, and they refused to perform the music live. My world was cold and empty, yeah. Despite friction between the band and the record company, a second album was recorded, Power of Love, again produced by Dallas Smith. Released in March of 1968, it was a little more in line with the band's actual musical direction, but like their debut, it flopped. In an attempt to regain control of their music, Hourglass went to Fame Recording Studios in Muscle Shoals, Alabama, on April the 22nd, where they recorded three tracks, Ain't No Good to Cry, a B.B. King medley, Been Gone Too Long, with Eddie Hinton as producer and Jimmy Johnson as engineer. The band were blown away by the results and said that they were the closest thing ever recorded as to how the band sounded live. How do you think I felt with you? However, the producer at Liberty thought the recordings were terrible and useless. Understandably, it fractured the relationship between the band and the record company. The tracks were shelved, but much later released on Duane Allman, an anthology in 1972. Duane Allman, an anthology volume 1974, and the box set The Allman Brothers Band, Dreams, in 1989. Having offended the band, Liberty expressed an interest in Greg Allman as a solo artist, and he remained in Los Angeles, while the rest of the band returned to St. Louis. After a few more local concerts, they disbanded at the end of 1968. Not quite clear what to do with himself, Duane Allman traveled to Muscle Shoals in September and asked Fame studio owner Rick Hall for a job as a session musician. Hall already had his own session musicians called the Muscle Shoals Rhythm Section, aka the Swampers. And the straight-up producer and studio owner was not so keen on the long-haired hippie. Hall described Allman as a lily-white man with a body like a stick and yellow hair straight as a horse's mane all the way down to his waist. When you looked at him with all of that hair and straggly moustache, he looked like a sad-eyed old hound dog hungry for attention. Hall eventually gave Allman a break, and he played on sessions by Clarence Carter and Wilson Pickett. Let's check out that incredible session, that incredible first session with Duane Allman playing with Clarence Carter. We have the wonderful Rodney Hall, Rick Hall's son, to take us through it.
Let's go listen to that guitar tone. That's ripping, like literally.
Here's the
Once in the studio, the sad-eyed 21-year-old dramatically changed personality with the help of some substance, as described by one of the regulars at Fame Studios, guitarist and songwriter John D. Weicker. After Duane made sure his guitar was in tune and he had the settings on his amp just like he wanted it and his headphone level was satisfactory, he asked for a short break before actually recording his part. Duane and I disappeared to one of our many secret places out behind Fame, and he began to get his head right. That's all I can say about that, but you all know what I mean. When he was finally ready, Duane strolled back into the studio with that sure-footed, cocky attitude that he was so famous for. Shook back his long, flaming, reddish hair, slipped his headphones on, picked up his magic guitar, slung the wide leather strap across his shoulder, closed his eyes and nodded to the engineer in the control room that he was ready. This moment was what this day was all about. Those few magic minutes of recorded sound on magnetic tape where Duane Allman knew that he could forever become immortal and unforgettable simply by playing his heart out on his guitar ride. He began to play, or should I say burn, with an intensity that bordered on recklessness. Later, in September of 1968, Greg Allman returned to Daytona Beach in Florida, where he was joined by his older brother. Both participated in sessions and concerts with a folk rock band called The 31st of February. Demo sessions at TK Studios in Miami, engineered by Steve Alamo, were later released on an album called Duane and Greg Allman. The brothers' involvement with the band ended when Greg returned to LA to record a solo album for Liberty Records to fulfill their contract. Sometime in the second half of 1968, Duane Allman discovered slide guitar playing. Greg Allman remembers that his older brother started using the slide on his birthday, November the 20th. However, according to Hourglass bassist Pete Carr, Duane Allman started after seeing Taj Mahal and slide guitarist Jesse Ed Davis perform in Los Angeles, which would have put the date before June 1968. Allman indeed already played slide on the Duane and Greg Allman album, recorded in September, and on Clarence Carter's recording at Fame from early November. Whatever the exact date, it's worth recounting Greg Allman's recollection from his autobiography, My Cross to Bear. He wrote that he bought his older brother a bottle of Coricidin, an anti-cough remedy, and a copy of Taj Mahal's self-titled second album for his 22nd birthday. Greg left the items on his brother's doormat in the morning. In the evening, the phone rang and Duane urged his younger brother to come over as quickly as possible. He'd fallen in love with the slide playing on the album by Jesse Ed Davis. Removed the red pills from the Coricidin bottle and the label and spent the whole day practicing slide. Allman concluded, from the moment that Duane put that Coricidin bottle on his ring finger, he was just a natural. Duane Allman was indeed a natural in every sense of the word. But like every musician, he did pay his dues. He practiced hard and studied records by the likes of blues and jazz greats like Robert Johnson, Elmore James, Muddy Waters, Kenny Burrell, Chuck Berry, and B.B. King, and later also Jeff Beck and Eric Clapton. When Allman develops his slide playing, he listened to a lot of blues harmonica playing, for example, by Sonny Boy Williamson, and he imitated blues harmonica licks on the slide guitar. Allman also closely scrutinized the playing of jazz horn players. He listened to Miles Davis' Kind of Blue for 2 years. Miles Davis does the best job, Duane Allman explained, of portraying the innermost, subtlest, softest feeling in the human psyche. He does it beautifully. John Coltrane, probably one of the finest and most accomplished tenor players, took music farther than anybody I have ever heard. All of these wide-ranging influences resulted in a unique guitar style, fluid and raw at the same time, with an immaculate sense of timing and articulation. Using standard tuning and a standard 351 celluloid pick for non-slide playing, and mostly open E and his fingers for slide playing, Allman was a master of melody. He developed melodies, and his solos were like a story, with a beginning, a middle, and an end. Allman could play fast, but also often used long lines, bending and playing with the pitch in an exceptionally smooth and subtle way, manipulating feedback between his pickups and the speakers for sustain that was part of his sound. Allman also was an excellent rhythm and acoustic guitarist, and producer Jerry Wexler remembers him as one of the most versatile guitar players he ever worked with. He was a complete guitar player. He could give you whatever you needed. He could do everything. Play rhythm, lead, blues, slide, bossa nova with a jazz feel, beautifully, light acoustic, and with a slide, he got the touch. A lot of slide players sound sour. To get clear intonation with the right overtones, that's the mark of genius. Duane is one of the greatest guitar players I ever knew. Allman played on many sessions at Fame Studios, not always credited as he often just dropped in. But some of the more notable sessions were with Clarence Carter, Arthur Conley, Ronnie Hawkins, Boz Scaggs, and King Curtis. On November the 27th, 1968, he convinced Wilson Pickett and Hall to record a cover of the Beatles' Hey Jude, which was at that point riding high in the charts. Allman's solo at the end of the track has become the stuff of legends. Rick Hall was mightily impressed with the cover of Hey Jude and played Atlantic Records boss Jerry Wexler the recording via the telephone. Wexler immediately decided to release it as a single, spreading the news of an unknown great guitarist at Fame. The single became a hit and reached number 23 on the US charts. It also came to the attention of Eric Clapton, who later remarked, "I remember hearing Wilson Pickett's Hey Jude and just being astounded by the lead break at the end. I had to know who that was immediately, right now. To this day, I've never heard better rock guitar playing on an R&B record. It's the best." As an aside, Wilson Pickett nicknamed Allman Skyman because he reached for the stars while playing. Though another version of the story says it was because Allman was always high. Skyman was also combined with Allman's other nickname, Dog, because his strawberry blonde hair resembled that of an Afghan hound. As a result, Allman became known as Sky Dog. During his time with Hourglass, Duane Allman had been playing a Fender Telecaster with a Stratocaster neck and a Vox V8161 fuzz box attached to the guitar, going through a Marshall amp with six 10-inch speakers. But by the time he played at Fame, he had switched to a 1954 Stratocaster with a Dallas Arbiter fuzz face with worn-out 9-volt batteries because they gave a warmer distortion. He also used a Maestro Echoplex and a Fender reverb amp with JBL speakers and a 1959 Fender Bassman. Duane Allman returned to Muscle Shoals in January of 1969 and recalled, "I rented a cabin and lived there alone on Wilson Lake. I just sat and played and got used to living without a bunch of jive Hollywood crap in my head. It's like I brought myself back to earth and came back to life again, through that and through the sessions with good R&B players." Duane Allman played on more sessions at Fame during the first months of 1969 with the likes of Otis Rush and King Curtis, and also went to New York to participate in sessions with Aretha Franklin, run by Jerry Wexler and producer Tom Dowd at Atlantic Studios. Meanwhile, Rick Hall was intent on signing Allman, but had to wait until the guitarist's contract with Liberty was dissolved, which finally happened on January the 23rd. Following this, Allman immediately recorded 8 songs for a planned solo album under the name Skyman Allman. There were more solo sessions in February, and 2 songs from these sessions, Happily Married Man and No Money Down, were later released on Duane Allman, an anthology in 1972, and a 3rd song, Going Down Slow, on an anthology 2, 1974.
I seen a Cadillac sign. It said no money down. So I eased on my brake, and I pulled up there in the drive.
By the end of March 1969, Allman wanted more musical freedom, and he went over to Jacksonville, where he started jam sessions with friends. He explained, "We all got together and jammed for a couple of months, putting together songs and stuff. We needed a singer, and Greg was the guy. 2 weeks after Greg got back from California, we went up to New York and recorded there." Allman reaching out to his brother at this point was a stroke of good fortune, in more than one sense, because Greg was deeply depressed as a result of having to make music he didn't like, and suffering a painful love affair. He later said, "I'd been building up nerve to put a pistol to my head." His brother's phone call could have not come at a better time. In addition to the brothers, it featured Dickie Betts on lead guitar, Barry Oakley on bass guitar, Butch Trucks and Jay Johanny J-Mo Johansson on drums. The heavy 2 drummers and 2 lead guitarists lineup came to define the sound of the band, and was the result of Duane Allman having heard James Brown, the first band leader with 2 drummers, and his own overdubbing and experiments in the studio, resulting in two lead lines, sometimes doubling parts, sometimes playing harmonies. The dual lead guitar concept did away with the usual lead rhythm guitarist separation that had until then been commonplace. On May the 1st, the Allman Brothers Band moved to Macon, Georgia. Phil Walden, who had managed Otis Redding, was looking for a new act to take under his wing, and also to set up a new record label, Capricorn, that was also to be distributed by Atlantic. Walden arranged for the band to record at Redwall Studio in Macon, which later became Capricorn Studio. 10 days later, Atlantic bought Duane out of his contract with Rick Hall for $10,000. The contract was later sold on to Walden. The Allman Brothers Band started to tour constantly and built up a formidable live reputation. Greg also grew enormously in his role as a lead singer and as a songwriter. In August, the band went into Atlantic Studio in New York for sessions for their first album, which was to be produced by Tom Dowd. But when he couldn't make it, house engineer Adrian Barber stepped in. Because they were touring so much, the band had the material down cold and recorded all the tracks in only 6 days. Duane Allman found time in October to play on recordings by Lulu and Aretha Franklin at Criteria Studios in Miami. But all eyes were set on the release of the band's self-titled debut album on November the 4th. However, the album only reached 188 in the Billboard Top 200 and was largely met with indifference, leading to the record company to pressure the band to move to New York or Los Angeles. The band resisted this and preferred to remain in Macon, where their presence had, as one of them said, transformed the sleepy town into a very hip, wild and crazy place filled with bikers and rockers. Despite the lukewarm response, the album marks significant artistic progress, with classic tracks like It's Not My Cross to Bear and Whipping Post embodying the band's southern rock style that integrated rock with blues, jazz and country. The band continued touring and recorded their second album over several months in 1970 and in various studios, Capricorn Sound, Criteria, and Atlantic South in Miami, and Regent Sound in New York City. The resulting album was called Idlewild South and released in September of 1970. It was produced by Tom Dowd, who remarked, "They were working 300 days a year, so they would just blow in and do some songs and blow out. That was it, in and out, just like that." Named after a wooden cabin, Idlewild South didn't do much better in the charts than its predecessor, despite the group's growing live reputation and tracks that would later become band classics and staple of rock radio, like Revival and Midnight Rider. I've got to run to keep rolling, despite the problems, the band had to reach a wide audience. Duane Allman's reputation as a great guitarist was spreading around the world. While performing with the Allman Brothers, he used several different guitars, including a 1961 Fender Stratocaster, a Gibson ES-345, a 1957 Gibson Les Paul Standard Gold Top, which he traded for a 1959 Gibson Les Paul Standard Cherry Sunburst, a 1958 Gibson Les Paul Standard Tobacco Sunburst, and a 1961 Gibson SG for slide. His amplifiers were a Marshall 50-watt head with two Marshall 4x12 cabinets with JBL speakers. Allman's acoustics included a 1930s National Duellian, a Dobro wood body, a 1940s Kalamazoo KGN-12, and a 1960s Gibson Heritage. Duane Allman's growing reputation as a world-class guitar player was illustrated by events in Miami around the time of the album's release. The Allman Brothers performed a concert in the city on August the 26th, at the same time that Eric Clapton and Derek and the Dominoes were recording their debut album at Criteria Studios. When Clapton learned that the guitarist on Hey Jude was set to perform in town, he came to the show. The two guitar stars met after the gig, hit it off, and jammed overnight. Duane Allman ended up playing on 11 of the 14 tracks on Layla and Assorted Love Songs, including classics like Bell Bottom Blues and the title track. Allman explained that Clapton played the Fender parts while he played the crunchier parts on a Gibson using a Fender Champ. According to Clapton, Allman was the musical brother I never had but wished I did. The album became a huge success, and Clapton invited Allman to become a permanent member of the band. He declined, choosing to remain with his own band. For the rest of 1970 and much of 1971, the Allman Brothers Band continued with its relentless touring schedule. Despite them playing to full houses, the result of their stellar reputation as one of the country's best live acts, all the group members, apart from the brothers, had trouble making ends meet. Greg received extra money from song royalties and Duane from his session work. The situation was so desperate that the band's tour manager killed a promoter for not paying the band. Given the limited success of the studio albums and the band's fearsome live reputation, it seemed a logical step to release a live album. Producer Tom Dowd and engineers Aaron Barron and Sam Whiteside therefore recorded two shows at the Fillmore East in New York on March the 12th to 13th, 1971. And the lightly edited results were released as a double album at Fillmore East. The album quickly stormed the charts after its release on July the 6th and became the Allman Brothers Band's most successful release. Over time, the stature of At Fillmore East grew to it being regarded as one of the most influential live albums of all time. It's been called the pinnacle of the Allmans and Southern Rock at its most elastic, bluesy and jazzy, and the finest live rock performance ever committed to vinyl. In 2004, the Library of Congress included it in its National Recording Registry, and it is regularly included in Best Albums of All Time lists. In 2020, the Independent newspaper in the UK declared it the greatest live album of them all. Duane Allman continued to do session work throughout 1971, often dropping in at sessions unannounced and not getting credited afterwards, making it impossible to compile a proper discography. He also was becoming a huge influence on contemporary guitar players, starting with his bandmate Dickie Betts, but was also on the likes of Joe Walsh, Gary Rossington of Lynyrd Skynyrd, and reportedly, he taught Don Felder to play slide. By the fall of 1971, Skyman, or Skydog, was, to all intents and purposes, on top of the world. This is sadly the moment in which a Hollywood movie would start playing foreboding music, because on October the 29th, Allman was killed in a motorcycle accident in Macon. He was driving at high speed on his Harley-Davidson Sportster motorcycle when a truck in front of him stopped suddenly. Allman lost control and he died soon afterwards from internal injuries. He would have turned 25 a month later. Everyone expected the Allman Brothers Band to throw in the towel, but shell-shocked, they nevertheless managed to create a follow-up album in honour of their fallen band member. Eat a Peach was released in February 1972. And another double album named after the words by Duane Allman, I Eat a Peach for Peace. It contained live and studio recordings with him and three tracks recorded after he passed. Melissa and Blue Sky became classic songs, and the album reached to number 4 on the Billboard album charts and went platinum. The success of the album inspired the band to continue, and it remained active until 2014, barring two brief pauses. In addition to being a core member of the band, Greg Allman also enjoyed a successful solo career until his death of liver cancer in 2017 at the age of 69. What his younger brother Duane achieved in his short life and very brief spell at the top remains astonishing. And his guitar playing continues to inspire new generations of guitarists. More than 50 years after his passing, his music is still able to transcend time, different generations, and cultures. It is an illustration of the power of music. And in these fractured times, it's perhaps best to conclude with Allman's own perspective on this. There are a lot of different forms of communication, but music is absolutely the purest. You can't hurt anybody with music. You can maybe offend somebody with songs and words, but you can't offend anyone with music. It's just all good. There's nothing at all that could ever be bad about music. It's a wonderful thing, a grace. It's hard to add anything more powerful than Duane Allman's own words, and you can't really disagree with that. Music brings people together. And as you've probably heard me, or maybe heard me if you've watched some of these other videos we've done in the series, the greatest music is where you blend genres together. And the blessing of going to Fame Studios and listening to some of the earliest recordings of Duane Allman was you realize just how much blues and R&B he had in his playing. The man was funky. He had such an incredible groove. Where a lot of rock can be quite sterile and almost perfect at times, Duane and the Allman Brothers had a funk groove, an R&B feel that mixed with rock created something completely unique. And I hope you really enjoyed this because it's been a pleasure to make this and it was an incredible honor to get to go to Fame Studios and talk to Rodney Hall and hear some of those original recordings in the room that they were recorded in. Thank you everybody for watching. God bless you, Duane, for having such an incredibly short but important, prolific, amazing career for us to be able to enjoy. Thanks, everyone. So long, farewell, à wiedersehen, au revoir, ciao, heydor, farewell. Please leave any comments and questions below. And of course, let us know any other artists or bands or songs or albums that you'd like to hear or see in this series. Thank you. Goodbye.